I wish to start this presentation by quoting a sentence announced by Lacan in his third seminar, Psychosis. It's always good not to let one's horizon narrow. It was in 1955-56. Despite the critical eye that Deleuze and Guattari's books cast on Freudian psychoanalysis and on Lacan's concepts, it can be considered that this sentence shows their possible encounter in the same will to extend, if not to erase, the boundaries of thinking, being, or experience. I'm going to present some pieces, and in fact, I'm just going first to present a bit my background when I discovered first Deleuze and Guattari's. So I was intrigued by psychoanalysis. I had done the psychoanalysis and I studied psychology, and so a few concepts were very inspiring for my music. For example, Freud and Lacan's work, and as well as Danon Unicode with potential space and a transitional object, two concepts very interesting. I will go back to that further. Some of the psychoanalytical works, more particularly focused on the time of the unconscious, were also really inspiring in the first stage of my research. Sylvie Pichet, for example, in a book called The Work of Time in Psychoanalysis, presented some concepts like reversive time, identifying time, which means... Sorry, I don't see very much. Can I have a bit more light? retrospective identification of amnesic traces, thanks to the collision of different times. André Green, another psychoanalyst, developed three interconnected concepts of the unconscious time: retroactive reverberation, anticipative annunciation, and associative irradiation. And these concepts account for potential multiplicity of unconscious connections and rebounds between elements. So I was already permeated with these concepts when I read Deleuze and Guattari, and through these readings I came to conceive musical creation as a projection of a personal and imaginary body, and I developed some processes in order to recreate the time of the unconscious. The important key themes of my music at that time, when I first discovered these philosophers, were: one, multi-layered time-inducing plural memory with forward and backward movements in a network of resonances, ricochets, echoes between fragmentary sound units; two, multiple sound connections and ramifications, interruptions, junctions; three, a plasticity of form, which is not preformed, but which is the result of trajectories of sound units; four, an elasticity of sound matter due to torsion between the different layers; and five, a system of repetition. So it's interesting to note that these sound properties I had developed can be envisaged both in the psychoanalytical field and in the Deleuzean perspective. I have developed a few concepts. Sorry, I cannot see the screen on this. Better. A few concepts. For example, I have developed per sounds. It's a game on words in French, pulsion and son. And I said pulsion and I translated into per sounds. I also, from Lacanian's concept of signify, signifying chain, signifying network, I propose sonify, sonifying chain, signifying network. And in fact, it's a concept at the border of Lacan's signify and Guattari a signifying signifier, also a signifying particle, as it was saying, because it's only a sonifying function, so it's not a signifier like for Lacan, because it's linked to the language, but it's also more than a signifier, and we'll explain why. So, and also from the dry objects that Freud had developed, I also developed fleeting objects, advanced on sound objects, which are all always distortable, always moving and traveling through space. So this approach at the intersection of psychoanalysis and music has been an interesting entrance door to Deleuze and Guattari's philosophy, since all their thinking is articulated around the concept of unconscious and varying productions of desire. Both philosophers brought an original viewpoint, going back to a certain extent to the origins of psychoanalysis. They set again focal point on Freud's first conception of the unconscious conceived as a factory, and not with his later option for a symbolic dimension. In Anti-Oedipus, for example, they, as you know, they dispute the interpretative drift of psychoanalysis, the importance given to representative content of the unconscious. For them, of course, the unconscious is machinic, so constantly at work, capable of production, animated by micro-processes, micro-machinisms. It's a space of pure sensation, emptied of significance or figuration, and since the assemblage is traced by asignifying particles, reveal rather more diagrammatic modalities, the field of force, and I quote Deleuze, intense and Deleuze and Guattari, intensive quantities in their pure state. Deleuze had already mentioned in difference and repetition a different unconscious. I quote, the unconscious is differential, involving little perceptions, and as such, it's different in kind from consciousness. It concerns problems and questions which can never be reduced to the great oppositions or the overall effects that are felt in consciousness. For me, this concept of differential and repetition, difference and repetition, or repetition and difference in my case, or micro-repetition and micro-difference, was very important for my music. So in my series order of release in 2002-2004, I worked on different properties on sound structure. Sorry? Oh, okay.
That's not normal, it should change. Sorry, there's a problem with the screen. Normally it should stay public. Stop the state. You have it? No. I have it and you don't have it. Mysterious. Okay, technology, we had this talk just before. So, when I have it here, I don't see it here, which is problematic. Okay, I have to turn. So, in my series Order of Release, Order of Relish, I worked on different properties of the sound structure, the opposition between the virtual and actual levels, the distinction between actualization and realization, the latter consisting in the production of ephemeral and fleeting sound objects cut out from the virtual matrix, which you can see here, and then a differentiated repetition. In fact, in this machinery, you have 8 superimposed layers. It's a matrix which is meant to remain virtual, latent. I didn't use it for the piece. It was only before the piece. And you see that it's a repeated movement with scales which are all the time repeated, but come back to the original point and are dissolved, gradually dissolved. And for me, it was kind of eternal return. There is no clear identity, no determinant form. Some particles flow repeatedly in a circular movement, which might never end, since the units come round to the same original reaggregate, as I said, once they have announced the set scale. If I quote Deleuze in difference and repetition again, eternal return cannot mean the return be identical, because it presupposes a world, that of the will to power, in which all previous identities have been abolished and dissolved. So for me, this matrix can be envisaged as, I quote, the formless being of all differences, the formless power of one, and each reiteration of chains expresses its possible actualizations, its different degrees of power, I quote again. And the alternation of sound units and voids in this matrix, the restless circulation of minimal entities which never find a definite place, manifest that, I quote Deleuze in the logic of sense, as in a game, we participate in the combination of the empty place and the perpetual displacement of a piece. And I was interested also that in the quote, Deleuze opposes two couplings, the virtual and the actual, and the possible and the real. And for me, what was interesting in this kind of matrix, I had the virtual matrix with different possible actualizations because I could change, I had the same constraints, but I could decide that, for example, here there's a process of slowing down, there could be a process of acceleration, or I could change the scales, the disposal of the intervals, or this kind of thing. So there would be different actualizations, but it wouldn't be in the piece yet. And then from this matrix, I think it's already explained here. From this matrix, I merge 2 layers in one for each instrument because there were only 4 instruments in this piece, so the 8 layers became 2 for each instrument. And then from this layer, you can see below, I cut out some objects. So I just cut one piece as if I was cutting with some scissors in a way. From this matrix, and it became an object, and this object was really audible in the piece, and keep the same rotary movement and now oscillated along an axis, like that. You have an example, an excerpt from the score here. What is in the red squares are the objects which were cut out from the matrix and which oscillate around the horizontal axis, and they can connect together, so it leads to odd zones, eventually harmonic zones, so they are modular and can widen space or travel through space as well. This is the functional aspect of this kind of objects. And in fact, in the perspective, there is also a concept which was very interesting to me. It was the concept of object time. I quote in the form again, the object, Deleuze, the object is no longer defined by an essential form that reaches a pure functionality as if declining in family of curves framed by parameters inseparable from a series of possible declensions or from a surface of variable curvature, but it is self-describing. This new object we can call object time. And for me, in Deleuze's perspective, the rotary objects that I developed in this piece, but then in other pieces as well, I can call them object tiles, and they have a paradoxical property because they fall and dissolve and they repeat and mutate at the same time. They form curvature of space-time. That's why I showed this kind of photo as well, which is the first one is a photo I've taken in New York. It was on the grid. And then I made some distortions of space just to show how only by moving some directions of threads or curves, you can get to other space and also get a curvature space. So from this object I just mentioned in this excerpt, you have here an example of the score again, where you have a process of mutation. The object tiles more and more are more and more dissolved and lead to what I named pendulums, three pitch pendulums mostly. Pendulum, why? Because of course they have pendular attitude or behavior, let's say. And these pendulums are very important in my music. I think that since this piece, I have all the time used this kind of pendulums for several reasons. In fact, they have several functions. First of all, their mobility, because they oscillate, so they can, according also to the variation of their amplitude, again, they can go to other tones. They are modular, so they can connect together and make some chains of pendulums, or what I call eventually sonifying chains. Also, they can be, the contours can be distorted if we change the place of the intervals, permutation, this kind of thing. And they can be fragmented. The three pitches can become two, or they can be augmented, three, etc. So for me, it's interesting because it's a modular and mobile object. It's not anymore an object for me, it's or even an abstract figure. Or I can conceive it in two ways. Whether it's an abstract figure, mostly triangular in a way, whether it can be a play of forces if we just keep the idea of a curve. So here, for example, you can see in the higher part of the page, the pendulum, three dots. The three dots are three pitches, eventually in music, and they are mostly in my pieces linked by glissandi, so it gives a curve. That's why I gave the curve on the right. Then, for example, you have the third picture. These pendulums can be transplanted onto any element, a sustained pitch, chord, whatever. So that's the way also they can move and they can go to other directions. And they can stack together and give chain, as I said before. And you see in the image which is just below, it's a process of mutation with four strings. And these four strings have, each one has a pendulum, and each pendulum has a differentiated repetition. Each time it's varied, but they are not varied at the same time, which causes a really distortable and elastic matter when you listen to the whole matter, in fact. So this is an excerpt from a piece which is called Fluctuation in Anime, and I was working on fluctuations of space-time in this piece, among other things. What is interesting is that this is an excerpt from the score. This excerpt from the score, in fact, is the thing that you've seen on the diagram just before. I go back to the diagram. I just made the diagram after I had finished the score. and in fact, it was just to show how these pendants were mutating and making the disposable matter more and more. But it can be visualized in another way, because I have three possibilities. Here you have four layers of pendulums, but if you decide to draw the envelope of four pendulums which were at the beginning at the same time, homophonic, let's say, as they have different metrical schemes, more and more the envelope is distorted, malleable, and becomes more and more elastic, and that's why on the third line I just draw the envelopes to show how the matter became elastic, only because each unit was moving and had a different intervals, different duration, this kind of thing. Well, it's just some photos I have taken as well to show how my... So I go a bit quicker, and already speak very quickly. I'm just playing maybe another cartography. So it's the same piece, it's a string quartet, and I just wanted to make kind of cartography of flux. Of the whole piece, so it's a way you can see how the matter evolves with the curves and with the variations. Sometimes it's homophonic, it rises on the same place together, sometimes it's more distorted. This is the second part of the piece. And if I show another way of visualizing these curves, this flux, it becomes envelope flux, and we have these kind of object types which are very variable, more and more. But this is the same piece, but I can visualize it in different ways. If I visualize these examples, I'm sorry, I don't show that because I don't have much time, so I go in between the images. Okay, and here, so it's again to show that what is interesting to me, that's why I talk about the virtual and the actual level, is that when I write some pieces with different layers, it's as if I was trying to make audible the virtual levels of what is going to happen. So at the same time, as if, for example, I had different lives at the same time. So I show four different layers, but they have each actualization of virtuality. And so here, for example, above you see the chains, and if the direction changes again, you can see that it's not the same chain, or it's not the same network, or the same sonifying network. But I can go as well a rhizome, of course, because it's very interconnected. And in my music, I think I write also some rhizomes in a way, because it's really interconnected tiny elements which make matter, which all the time is distortable. So this concept of rhizome, it makes, I have some processes which can go, it made me arrive to more hybrid becomes, because when I started this series, transversal between the psyche and the city. I was very interested in Subway in Paris because the sounds were really like animal groans, between human and animal, between sound and noise, between living and non-living organisms. And for me, so it was very interesting, this border, which is really something very important in our century now, more and more with the DNA transplantations, all these kind of things. So I was thinking of a kind of artificial man, between man and machine as well, and I did this kind of map, which was obvious for me that the network system was very close between the brain and the subway, and I worked at the same time on structural level with connectivity and the speed also of circulation, and also on the ambiguity of the sounds, which were really a bit hybrid. That's the thing with that. So I was working on a hybridization of sound and transgeneric music in a way. Again, here there's a process again of the same kind in the same piece of Tiche Cité Transversale. It's the last piece, which is called Villa Rupta. And sometimes when I visualize flux, I call that an electromusicogram, in reference, of course, to the electroencephalogram, because I was really working on this projection of the psyche outside of I think that the city is a projection of our psyche, and I was really working on a zone of indiscernibility, to quote Deleuze, or also on this potential space that Winnicott developed, a kind of zone of illusion where we don't know what is inside and outside, what is ego or non-ego. Sorry to
jump for the text, but I thought, well, Mutatis Mutandis, and I'm going to play a sample, and we'll finish on that, at least a bit, some music. Again, it was a kind of hybridization. I came from the DNA, of course, and I was interested in drawing some corporeal postures, which were coming from the DNA. Also, this is this one excerpt from the score, and you can see the connectivity also of dots, which are pitches and durations. And also this kind of drawing where I interconnected dots with curvature space-time again, and we have different actualizations. In this drawing also, I propose the different actualizations and I superimpose them as I do in my music. When I do some drawings like that, it's just also to make more evident what I'm talking about music. But now I can play some sample of a piece which was related to these drawings, and which is called Mutatis Mutandis, for 12 amplified instruments, string instruments, which was really working also, of course, on this process of mutation, distorted all matter. But in a way of nanofabrication, in a way, that's why I'm talking about nanomusic, because the whole matter is distorted, because inside all the units are completely all the time moving and fabricating, building up a moving organism in a way, moving somebody. And in a way, before I present just a sound sample, a single one, I refer also to the body valve organ that I call for myself. I prefer to name it the organum body or organum body, which is referring to music, of course, an organum or an organum. You know that in medieval arts it was music. And for me, music is really a vibrating body, and so that's why it's interesting to name it that way in reference to this body without organs. So I'm going to